Back when I was a wee lad dipping my toes into the solo run waters, Snorlax was the first how fast run that I did, and it just wasn't that great. Without going into it too much, I thought that Harden and a physical moveset would do the best, and I just kind of ran with that. 18 months later, I have more knowledge, more skill, and the tools to be much more precise for these runs, and given how much I like this hungry boy, I wanted to get this one right. I originally live streamed Snorlax 2 times, and it still didn't feel that great, so today I decided to give you guys new footage. And before we begin, likes and comments go a long way in helping small channels grow, so if you want to help out whether you are someone new or a returning subscriber like Tiger Festival, scroll down and tell me what you think about Snorlax, or what you think about the run, and if you are someone that doesn't know what to say or normally doesn't comment, just type in "he hungy" because we gonna eat today. The first thing that I will mention here is that I guess the, I don't know what the odds are. You have a 1 in 151 chance to get the same random Pokemon that you're running. And today, Snorlax is the random Professor Oak Pokemon on the same day we're running Snorlax. So jot that down for a historic moment in the channel. Snorlax is just a really interesting Pokemon to me. 160 base HP is just massive, it's beefy, and 110 attack is among the elites of the game. The rest of the stats are not really that great, but the one thing that really kind of makes this run, I guess, kind of unique here is that it has 30 base speed, and that's really going to hamper a lot of things in your strategy going forward. With really high attack and the fact that you start off with Headbutt and you get access to a pretty early Body Slam along with moves like Earthquake and Rock Slide that I didn't list on the side, it's very intuitive to think that you would just lean on that attack and go that route like I did my first run, but Amnesia, it's no surprise to anybody that watches the channel or watches other solo run channels, it's one of the strongest moves in the game. Now, without going into it and over explaining it here, Special is a unified stat, meaning that it encompasses both offense and defense, and a move that raises that 2 times just makes you absurdly strong offensively and really bulky to go along with that massive 160 base HP. Everyone knows that in the late game, Special is kind of the king of Gen 1, so after lots of runs, this is what we're gonna go with, but at first, I think all the Snorlax runs are gonna look roughly the same. And today, guys, we are playing Yellow Version. I thought I should mention that real quick, even though you've probably seen it in the title, but I do think Yellow Version's easier early game is a benefit to a lot of Pokemon, especially the ones that have really good stats and a very diverse move pool, so the changes there don't affect them. But the early Brock split for Pokemon that only have normal moves like Snorlax here, they can benefit greatly from that. Now, we don't need to run through every single change like I did in the Nidoking early game, but I do immediately face the optional rival battle, and with Headbutt and a really high attack, there's not much to say here, and that's our first stop. Now, what you will notice during this early game is I have to heal already, and that's because there's only 15 uses of Headbutt, and you have to use it pretty sparingly, and it's pretty tough to do enough battles to get past Brock without having to just keep backtracking to get your PP up, so doing it now makes the most sense. I faced the optional last first with the 2 Nidorans, and when I get done with that, I am level 8. And then I face the first optional bug catcher with the 2 Caterpies. Now, I do have a chance to one-shot his Pokemon here, and it does alleviate the burden of Headbutt PP here, but I don't get the range in this footage, and we just have to keep moving on. One of the big optimizations I made from all my previous runs is I take this third optional bug catcher on here that only has 2 Pokemon, and the experience roughly comes out the same way, even though you can save roughly maybe 2 or 3 Headbutts just facing this trainer instead of the previous one that has 2 Metapods. And by the time you finish up with the mandatory bug catcher, you're pretty much at 1 or 0 uses of Headbutt. You have to heal, and then we can finally talk about Brock at level 9. And there's not much to say about Geodude. Being in Yellow Version means he has 2 less levels on his Pokemon, and most importantly, the Geodude has no Defense Curl. That means our Headbutts will be hitting pretty hard, and with our very high base HP, we can just tank it and just Headbutt it until we move on. Onix is a little bit more interesting. With our abysmal speed, that means we are at the mercy of Bide, and all we can do is really Headbutt, And if he uses Bite first, we're just going to have to take a little bit of damage. And then you can eventually, for the one time in the run, use Rest to heal yourself back up. And eventually, slow and steady butts with our head, you can move on at a low level of 10. And at 16 minutes, it's not the fastest, but it is pretty good for a Pokemon with only normal moves. From there, we can start to kind of just skip past the next route. But it is worth noting that having only Headbutt at this point means that I do have to heal yet again. And that's something that most of the high tier Pokemon don't have to do. As for Mount Moon, the only thing interesting to note here is that I pick up Mega Punch. And that just means that we have a move that hits harder than Headbutt. But it also, more importantly, allows us to stretch our PP out and not have to heal as often, which is always a plus. Like with every run, at this point, when you make it to Cerulean, you have a choice, Rival number 2 or Misty. And in this case, I choose to go after Misty first. And the reason why you choose Misty for Snorlax is because you have Amnesia, you can get really bulky, you have that HP stat. All you have to do, and this does require a little bit of luck, Staryu comes in, you set up 2 or 3 Amnesias, you don't get crit, you take it out, and by the time you make it to Starmie, it's gonna have to crit you for you to pretty much lose the battle, and you can just Mega Punch it down, and that's kind of what's on display here. It went really smooth, it's really not that bad of a fight, obviously, since I went here first. Like with a lot of runs, Bubble Beam is the real prize here. With Amnesia, we finally have a move that can take advantage of it, and it's just really good coverage. Water coverage when you're only a normal type is just really good. And I would like to give a quick shout out to the JSON file that I was using for my type overlay. Bubble Beam was spelt out as 2 words, and it completely broke the game, and it took me like 5 hours to realize what was causing it. So that's always cool. Coding's fun. Now as for Rival number 2, I run an option play here. On turn 1, I'm just going to select Amnesia, and depending on if it growls me or not, I'll adjust my strategy accordingly. Here it growls me on turn 1, so I go ahead and set up to +6 in special. And with our neutered attack, I'm just gonna Bubble Beam for the rest of this fight. And since I'm set up, I can just pretty much take anything that comes my way. And Bubble Beam is hitting really hard with the Amnesias, and there's not much else to say after that. And as for Nugget Bridge and the route to Bill's house, to me, it's the most tedious part of the game. There's no reason to show it. Snorlax is very well equipped to handle it at this point, and we can just keep moving along. Down on the SSN, obviously it's time for Body Slam, and there's no body that you don't want to slam me more than Snorlax. 85 base power with Stab will be our strongest move for quite some time, and it makes this early to mid game really easy looking ahead. I do pick up the candy locked behind the gentleman, and now we can just go straight into Rival number 3. Spearow does his absolute best to just annoy the hell out of me by growling on turn 1, but even then, we can still just go on a tear with Body Slam. Now I do experiment with a couple of moves on the Eevee, but overall it's a very quick battle. And speaking of easy battles, let's look at Surge. But first, like if you were a gym leader, like we look at Misty for example, she's like, oh, I'm a water type, let's put like water all around my gym, it makes sense. And Surge for some reason is like, let's put trash cans in the gym, it doesn't make any sense. But anyway, as for Surge, he's only got 1 Pokemon in yellow version and he has bad AI, so we put his Raichu right in one of those trash cans. It goes for Thunderbolt, hits us hard, we Body Slam, paralyze it, and then we knock it out right after that. So there's not much more to say other than why does he have trash cans? Somebody tell me. The real prize for the fight here is Thunderbolt, just like Bubble Beam was with Misty, and it's very intuitive to learn this move immediately because it makes Rock Tunnel's slow pokes very easy. But with Snorlax, one of the key optimizations that I made was to hold off on learning this move until the late game. This really frees up your move pool to allow you the freedom to learn a lot of things because Snorlax has a pretty deep move pool, and learning Thunderbolt now just means that you're really trying to crunch and put things in a certain order, and it really just kind of frees you up. Now we can skip ahead to Celadon, where the game really opens up, but first, before we run any errands, we're gonna immediately tackle the Rocket Hideout, and there's not really much to say here. I do pick up some high money items, and Giovanni's just really quick. Bubble Beam is really the only coverage you need for those rock types, and it's just double super effective, so you already know how it's gonna go. After that, it's time for a pretty early Celadon mark buy. Normally I hold off if I can, but when I'm going for speed, you look at the route and what a Pokemon needs, and I need these TMs here today. And with all the buying and selling and haggling I did today, we're going to be buying 5 calciums, and don't you dare think about buying carbos for Snorlax, because there's pretty much only one situation I can think of that the 3 free carbos help you out, but outside of that, you got base 30 speed, just live with it. Immediately after that, I head to Saffron, and I go ahead and pick up Psychic from Mr. Psychic because Gen 1's very creative with names, and then I can learn both Psychic and Ice Beam, and that makes our moveset very formidable at the mid-stage of the game. Afterwards, I decide that I'm going to tackle Erica first, and there's lots of runs to where usually the execute single trainer on the left is faster, but it's kind of annoying if it's faster than you, and if you need just a little bit more experience, this cool trainer right here is very rich in experience. I like going this route a lot, and I thought I would just mention it real quick because it's very easy even though I get paralyzed, but Snorlax is a very slow Pokemon, and obviously throughout the entire run, you're always going to be taking damage first, and that's one of the challenges with this run. And as for Erica herself, I don't even heal. All you need to do here, you have your choice of Psychic or Ice Beam. Ice Beam works on Latangela. Just set up a couple of Amnesias, couple of Ice Beams, it's down. We can move on just like that. That's why we came here first, folks. Afterwards, I do go to the Pokemon Tower. We don't have to go into it. The only thing I can really say about it is that I should have used Amnesia from the start, but I don't. So I take a little bit of damage from the Fearow. But other than that, it's trivial. We're one-shotting everything. We can skip over it. The Ghastlies are easy. We have Psychic. Let's move on with our lives. I then head down to the Safari Zone to pick up the final HMs of the run. And then I head back down to Fuchsia, and after I finish Koga's first 2 trainers, I use 5 rare candies right here to get to level 38, and now we can take a look at the very annoying Koga in yellow. And when your speed is this low, you really have to make some concessions in the run. There are going to be some battles where you just know that, hey, I'm probably going to have to reset here. It's fine if I do. So the plan here, ideally, you're going to want to get off 2 Amnesias on the Venonat, and then you can kind of clean sweep. And here, the worst case scenario happens. I get hit with Toxic, and I'm already on that clock. I get a little nervous. I try to just go ahead and just get ready for the sweep. And I probably would have got it here if the second Venonat didn't drop my special with Psychic, and I only noticed when I was watching the footage back. Needless to say, I make it to the very end. It's really close, but I do have to go down for my first reset of the run. On the second attempt, I set up once and I get put to sleep, and that's really not a bad position to be in because you can't get poisoned while you're asleep, and I can just kind of wait it out. If I was already set up, this would be perfect, but I'm not. I then take another special drop that I probably noticed. I hope I noticed it when I was playing it live. And eventually, with another special drop, I get taken too low, and I just can't keep up with the Venomoth. So that's 2 resets on Koga today. On the third attempt, I get what I need. I finally set up 2 times with Amnesia. I'm at plus 4 special. Then I get put to sleep. Now I am getting pelted here, I'm taking a lot of damage, and it's funny because I win this fight, but I want you guys to notice that I still get my special dropped by Psychic 2 times in this one fight alone, and I still almost lose, but still being at plus 2 special means that even though I'm really low, I can still tank a Psychic from Venomoth, and I take the battle, and we get the pretty useless speed badge boost that really doesn't matter for Snorlax. But this is one of the tougher fights in the run. You can tell by the fact that I had 2 resets, even though I pretty much fully optimized this run. Afterwards, I do head over to Silphco, and besides the rare candy on the 10th floor, I pick up Earthquake because it will be key later. And just like our friend Mickey Mouse would tell you, it's a secret tool that we're gonna use later, guys. And by later, I mean right away, because we're just immediately gonna learn it. We're gonna already replace Body Slam this early in the run. And we're going to break this Arbok in half real quick. And something that I briefly mentioned is that slower speed means that you're always going to take a punch from your opponent. And I never talk about this Hyper Potion here in Silph, but I love it. You can just go in the store and get it. It's pretty much a free full heal at this stage. And I always grab it when I'm running low on supplies. But I just don't think I've ever mentioned it in a video. So there you are. And now we can take a look at Rival number 5. Sandslash is first, and this is a rare case where we'll actually outspeed something after one badge boost, so even though it goes first, using one amnesia makes us outspeed, so we essentially get another free turn, and we can just knock it out after the special boost. Ninetales is next, and this is pretty much the key reason why I went ahead and learned Earthquake. It made the battle a lot tougher and inconsistent without it, so you could just use an Earthquake and it goes down really easy. Cloyster is next. We don't have a super effective answer for it yet, but its special isn't that great, and our special is boosted, so whatever it does, it really doesn't matter. It does take a couple of psychics to go down, but it's not really a threat. Kadabra is next, and normally this Pokemon's a little bit scary, but with that special boost working on our defense, we tank a Confusion very well, and then Kadabra does not tank an Earthquake very well, and we're moving on just like that. And at the end, we are facing the Jolteon team from the rival. That means that it's weak to Earthquake, and it goes down after it does some pretty decent damage with a double kick, and that's the fight over. Let's skip over the rest of Sylph, and instead pick right back up at the top of Saffron, looking at Sabrina. And here, we all know how this one starts. Abra's very annoying with Flash, and I wouldn't dare risk setting up here, so I go straight for Earthquake. And even though Sabrina goes for an X Defend, I can easily just cut through it still for a one-shot victory. Now, Kadabra does some pretty heavy damage, but it does hang on after an Earthquake, but after it uses Recover, I am able to take it out on the next turn. And as for the Alakazam, I'm already getting kind of low. You're probably expecting a crit or something in a reset here, but I crit. We got a 5.86% chance to crit, and Snorlax decides that this is the time it wants to just win the battle, and that's all we really need to say about it. From there, we can just take the nicest little swim down to Cinnabar we've ever taken in our entire life. And after doing nothing extra today, it's time for a little
Tombstoner, brother!
And now we can just take a look at Blaine. And there's not a whole lot to really say about this one. I do have Earthquake, but we've covered this ad nauseum that we're gonna have to go second in pretty much every fight, and Blaine outlevels us and has fast Pokemon. Now it starts early, I take a Confuse Ray, but I do get off my moves, I hurt myself only once. Now where I start sweating a little bit is when the Rapidash growls at me, and that makes my damage really weak. I didn't set up any earlier, and I get really low. I go all the way down to a mere 4 HP, but Snorlax looks back at me and it says, "I got you, bro." And another Earthquake finishes this one off, and it wasn't even close, guys. And now there's only one gym left, and Giovanni in yellow is very intimidating. But first, I do use 5 rare candies to get up to level 48 after the first Rhyhorn trainer in the gym, before I fight the double Machoke Machop trainer. And it's no secret to anybody that plays yellow version that this fight can be an absolute nightmare. Now, we're not necessarily weak to anything in this fight, but our slow speed makes this one really hard, and I want to say I reset something like 20 times on this fight when I was doing it on the live streams, which are Friday, by the way, if you want to watch that. But let's just take a look at Giovanni, level 48, damage rounding. Let's see how it went. Dugtrio is first, it's fast, it's really scary. Of course we're gonna go second. We take huge damage from an Earthquake, but the goal here is that I wanna set up Amnesia twice, and that puts me in a great position for the rest of the fight. I do take a Sand Attack, and that's not great, but we get a Guard Spec by Silphco here, and we get to move on to the rest of the fight. Persian is next. It can be really annoying and even scary sometimes, but it misses its move, and those two amnesias ensured that Ice Beam would be a one hit here. Now, are you ready for this, guys? This Nidoqueen here, this is the one fight in the game outside of the Sandslash to where 2 badge boost and the 3 calciums will put you ahead of it to move first and knock it out. I had to go back and redo a whole entire run because I thought I could skip one of those free Carboses, and this is the reason why you pick them up right here. But you are not faster than Nidoking, and that means it is going to get its chance with a double kick, and even though it does some really good super effective damage, we are boosted, and that Ice Beam moves us on to the end of the fight against the Rhydon. And speaking of slow Pokemon, this is... God, there's probably only 2 battles in the entire game where Snorlax is just gonna naturally outspeed something, and this is one of them, and it's weak to ice, and that's really all you need to know. That's the fight over. Now, this fight did look really easy, and you're probably thinking that I had everything planned out, and I did, But this fight was an absolute nightmare to route out on stream, and you can go check out the VOD for that if you want to see me failing over and over and over as I figure out this fight, and I'm glad we got it down to almost a science and things worked out here for us. Rival number 6 is immediately next, and we already know the play on the Sandslash from the previous fight. I know I can outspeed with one badge boost. That means I tank whatever move, I use Amnesia, now I outspeed, I get a free turn, and an Ice Beam can take us on. And speaking of slow, annoying, useless Pokemon, it's Execute everybody, and it can go down to one Ice Beam and burn in hell. Ninetales is next, and yes, it's true that Yellow has way better move pools in the late game, but it can't stop Gen 1 from being Gen 1. It goes for Roar, and it gets taken out right after that with an Earthquake. And for one of the few times, I'm just gonna speed up the rest of this fight. I don't have a super effective answer for Cloyster, but it doesn't matter because it's not very strong offensively and I'm special boosted, and everything else I can just one-shot, and I'm tanky enough to survive any damage, so we don't have to go into the details, the little play-by-play. I don't have to tell you that the water on Jolteon's spine was glistening as it charged up a double kick, so let's just move on and we can start thinking about the league. The one thing I will say about Snorlax and the rare candy usage to solve all these early problems means that we are behind in levels. We are only level 50, so I do pick up the rare candy in Victory Road, and I use it right before the league, and that gets me to level 51, and I also have to learn Thunderbolt here for obvious reasons. If you have to ask, then this is probably your first video, and I'm not gonna belittle you, and I hope you have a good time and enjoy the video. And this is a great example of holding off on Thunderbolt, how it helped me. I was able to utilize those other moves very strongly, and now I can just get rid of Ice Beam. That allows me to keep Psychic and Earthquake for now, and then I picked up Blizzard earlier, and we can make another moveset change later in the Elite Four. And now, my friends, we can start by taking a look at Lorelei. Dugong is up first, and it uses Takedown. That means on turn 2, it's very likely to go ahead and use Rest, so I set up. There's no need to go to plus 6 special, so 2 Amnesias will do, and that means from there, I can just pretty much clean sweep the fight, and there's really no worries. It's a clean sweep, and we can just move on. And speaking of clean sweeps, did you guys expect anything from Bruno? I just go in there, I use one Amnesia just to make sure the Machamp doesn't get like a submission crit or something crazy on me, and that just allows me to just pretty much sweep through everything with one fight and ensure that nothing can survive, and we can just move on. I actually talked about Bruno a little more than I usually do, so maybe he'll feel good about that. Just look at him. Next up is Agatha, and this is another key reason that you would want to hang on to Earthquake. With very high attack, it doesn't require any boost or anything special to one-shot everything since they are mostly all defensively frail, and that just means that I can just come in here and you pretty much just hope you don't get put to sleep or something crazy happens, and you can pretty much just Earthquake it down. Now in Yellow version, the first Gengar doesn't have Hypnosis, so to me it's not as annoying. It does have things like Substitute. And just in general, you guys know how annoying that Agatha could be, especially when you're just at the mercy with this very slow speed. And here, it looks really bad for a second. I get down really low, and then at the very end of the fight, I'm at 2 HP. I wake up, I'm still confused. I pretty much have a coin flip just to win the battle right then and there, and I lose the coin flip. And that's another reset, which is not too surprising. With Snorlax, you're gonna have some battles like this where you just lose because you're not very fast. And in the second attempt, you can just see the dichotomy between the two fights. I do set up an Amnesia, and that just means that I'm guaranteed to get the one-shot ranges with the Earthquake. Some of them, like the two Gengars, would be a range without it, so I set that up, it gets a Substitute, and I just pretty much sweep through the fight. I do get a little low, I get paralyzed, but at the end of the day, Earthquake, Agatha, like peanut butter and jelly, we win. Next up is Lance, and we're making another moveset change. I'm going to be replacing Psychic with Blizzard. It's pretty much ran its course. Blizzard's very powerful, I don't need to tell you that. But I picked up a PP up earlier, and I use it here because having only 5 uses doesn't feel great. I did have some resets in previous runs because I was just short because that 90% accuracy came into play. But one PP up, you're good. That's all your PP needs. And guys, it's Lance. We have Thunderbolt for the Gyarados and Blizzard for the Dragons. And you would think this would be really easy, But this fight was really hard. Now, I'm going to cut a long story short here. Now, the problem, one of the main problems, is that you have to set up Amnesia once on the Gyarados to make Thunderbolt a one-hit range, and the Amnesia really doesn't help. You probably could just go two straight Thunderbolts, but it makes some of the ranges on like the Aerodactyl a little bit better. And I've talked about this several times in the video, but it bears repeating that going second pretty much every move makes things really hard. Now, we're going to go through some footage in the background. I'm going to keep showing it, but I reset 5 times here. Whether it's the Gyarados Hyper Beam critting me, or the Dragonair's doing some bullshit to me, or the Aerodactyl hitting me hard, or the Dragonite hitting me hard, I have a lot of resets. Now, the absolute worst one, and the one that made me mauled the most, was the Dragonair getting a freeze proc on me and forcing a reset. And at the end of the day, I'm up to 8 resets at the end. And even on my final attempt, to where I feel like things went pretty well, I still barely won by the skin of my teeth, guys. I got down to 8 HP before I took out the Dragonite. And this fight was not clean. And honestly, I did not expect to have trouble here because I'm pretty sure I never did before. But like I said a long time ago, that's what happens when you hit that record button. Things that are unexpected happen often, and here we are with 8 resets. Let's just look ahead to the final battle to the champion. Sandslash is up first, and like with all optimized runs, this one is planned out very carefully, and that means I set up 1 amnesia. We've seen this time and time again. Then I use Blizzard and we take it out. I level up immediately after that, if you're wondering why I didn't set up more. And the plan here is to finish up setting up on the Alakazam, and since your special is going to be boosted, it won't do that much damage. But then again, it's the computer, the AI is going to crit you. I get down to 18 HP, I'm still slower, and that means this is another reset. We're up to 9 in the run. Sandslash is first, it's the same thing we seen last time, but it hits an earthquake. It does pretty heavy damage to us before we're able to move on. And this time, guys, the Alakazam allows us to set up. It doesn't crit, and you can see how well we can tank its moves. Luckily, it misses a Kinesis, and then we're able to be +6 boosted going into the Exeggutor. And this is once again one of those rare moments to where fully boosting ourselves not only allows us to one-shot this very beefy tree, but also we get to outspeed it, which means we don't get to see any Hypnosis, and that's very good. Cloyster is next, and you might be surprised that with just 2 badge boosts at 103 speed, we actually outspeed this little clam, and with Thunderbolt, we can send it back from whence it came, and that means Ninetales is next. It goes for a quick attack. That's not good enough, bud. That's an earthquake. That's the fight down. Jolteon comes in, it misses Pin Missile. That means we got a boosted earthquake coming its way. And that's it, the battle's over. And as fate would have it, at the very end, I level up to 56. And that's magically the level that we learn Hyper Beam. And just for Snorlax, we learn it. And that's it, Snorlax has done it. This was an extremely satisfying run to route out. But, as you guys can tell by the time, it's not really that close to the top, but it's still a really solid run. Now let's just take a look at the stats real quick. Snorlax finishes with a pretty low level of 56, with 9 resets that mostly all came on Lance, and a final time of 2 hours and 41 minutes. That means if we go ahead and bring up this tier list, we can zoom in, and we can see that on the second rung of the A tier is where I have Snorlax. It was emphatically better than War Turtle because War Turtle had double the resets. But it just isn't quite there for those really good runs like Nidoking, Zapdos, Machamp, Charizard, etc., etc. You can see the list. But it does plant itself firmly in that A tier. And I think the fact that you pretty much have to concede your first turn in pretty much every battle of the game, just it slows it down a lot. In the early game with Headbutt and having to overheal and stuff like that, if Snorlax had average speed, which why would it? Because it's Snorlax, just look at it, it would probably have a much better time. But as it stands now, I don't think, after doing 2 streams and many, many runs with Snorlax, I don't know how much faster its time could actually be. So I'm very happy with this result. We can put Snorlax to bed. And speaking of being put to bed, it's Mewtwo, everybody. And since I learned Hyper Beam at the end of the Elite Four, I thought my level 56 ass was gonna come in here, Hyper Beam the Mewtwo, be out, outro, end of video, but not so fast, my friends. It's not strong enough to one-shot it, and I go down like the dog that I am. On the second attempt, I'm still feeling the Hyper Beam in my heart, like we all should, like a good, pure-blooded American does. But it sets up Barrier pretty much immediately, so I swap over to some Amnesias, and eventually we take it out, and that's Mewtwo down. We're pretty much 15 levels lower, and we still got it done, which is pretty impressive. Snorlax is an impressive Pokemon. And speaking of impressive, special thanks to my channel members. We got Mariah Thompson, we got Meeves, JWJ, Mutus Dozen, D's Masters, TR2G Hipster, Cheesy Speakeasy, Josh Ferment, and Kendall C. I appreciate your support more than you know, and if you have become a member in the last couple of weeks, I probably went ahead and recorded this video some time ago, so you'll be on here eventually, don't be mad at me. Now as for me, I'm just gonna swim around in Cerulean Cave for the rest of my days, and if you guys wanna catch a stream on Fridays, I'm always there. Subscribe if you like the video, share it with a friend, I appreciate all the support. And guys, I did a new video technique today. I've been talking to Squidgy. I talked to Squidgy several times. He has a different editing style, so this one was kind of off the cuff, no script. So I'd really appreciate, especially for the real ones that make it this far, I'd really appreciate some feedback on that. But that's pretty much all I got for you. I'll catch you guys on the next one. I'm hoping this allows me to get out more videos faster so I don't have to take the time to do a script. But that's pretty much it. I'll catch you guys on the next one. Bye.